Good morning, Austin. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, guys. Hello. I cannot hear
people
very well.
Oh, what about now?
Oh, I see him.
Yeah, I just don't think anyone was talking. And I just updated the agenda, by the way, and I think I posted a link, so.
Yeah, I'll look at that. Mm-hmm. Do we know how many people are planning to show up for this one?
No, not exactly. I know Christian is going to be... Oh, Christian just joined. Okay. So far, yeah, we have a good amount of people so far. Definitely enough to continue with the meeting. There's Parody Geth, Ethereum J, C++, Python. We just need some Go people. Oh, and we also have Ethereum JS. Martin Beasy representing.
LOL.
Hi.
Good morning, Conrad. Looks like I'm in the bat cave or something. Should probably turn on a light. Good morning, Alex. Pretty good. Let's see. I might go into the Go channel and see if anybody can join. Is anyone from Go in here that I missed?
Daniel's on now.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Hey, Daniel.
Me and Daniel are sitting next to each other.
Oh, cool. Okay, and Jan's here from Ruby. Good morning, Jan. Or wherever, whatever time it is where you are. All right, so yeah, if Daniel's here, then I think we can start. Let me see, what's the first item? My page closed. It is, Christian, it's the EIP-211, so if you want to get started with that, you can go ahead and explain it and all that.
So I think we already talked about that last time, although it was not an official EIP, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, it wasn't yet.
It's again, so another solution for the problem that it's hard to return dynamically sized data from calls. And the proposal would be to create a buffer that is similar to the call data buffer, which does not have a position in memory, but is a separate buffer, and contains the full returned byte string. And there are two opcodes. One of them is returning the size, which returns the size of this buffer, and return data copy, which can be used in a similar way to call data copy, to copy data from that byte string into memory. There's one concern, and this is the problem that the memory of the callee has to, so it cannot be freed immediately after it returned. And this kind of this changes the memory requirements a bit. And there was a proposal to basically reset this buffer whenever memory is resized, and I didn't fully get why that can help. So could someone explain that, perhaps? Is Nick here?
I don't see him in here yet. I'll send him the link to see if he can join.
I think, or, I don't know, does anyone have a better insight into that?
If y'all could pull up the page, but Gavin, I think it was Gavin who suggested it, right?
Yes, and I think, Gavin's not here, but I think I've seen Nick also discussing that. Vitalik, do you have any comments about that?
Hold on, let me read through what Gav said here.
Yeah, he updated about 8 hours ago. He added a comment too.
Persist, define any memory resizing operation. So theoretically, like, calls are not necessarily resizing. I don't know, like, I really don't like his suggestion because I feel like it would require us to add in a bunch of extra hooks. Yeah, in order to figure out like what resized memory and what didn't.
Call certainly clears this buffer. So that's a separate thing.
Right. But like there's other things like mstore, call data copy, code copy and so forth where like in order to check if it resizes memory it's dynamic. So can you just remind me again what was wrong with like some of the earlier proposals? So things like EIP 5 and 8, where it only tried to you did a call, it would only fill up as much memory as it needed to instead of filling up the whole slice.
The gas calculations were really complicated. That was the main drawback for both proposals, I would say.
Is it just the fact that you'd have to add another gas check that's like in the middle of VM op execution and not just at the start, or was there something else? It's like I remember implementing EIP 8, I think, in Python, and all I did is I just moved over one of the memory expansion checks from the start of the code to the part of the code that actually allocates the memory at the end, and it didn't seem more complex.
So one of the proposals has the drawback that the call opcode can fail after. So
yes.
It can fail because of off-gas while it's already executing.
Mm-hmm.
And the other version had the drawback that the callee kind of has to reserve a bit of gas for the resizing the call as memory.
Yeah. Oh, right. The problem with this one is that I feel like it first of all, it increases the complexity of the object that has to be kind of passed around as computational state. So along with memory and stack and gas, we also have to worry about return data.
But it can be generalized as multiple segments of memory.
Right, but like that's an even weirder.
Yeah, I don't see that as a complication. I mean, return data is exactly the same object as call data, or it's very similar, and then you just have another one. I think it's better to have more objects than more complicated rules.
I don't know, I mean, I still don't...
So, when transcompiling this to WASM, I can handle it very nicely this way also.
So another benefit of this is that, I imagine call as a kind of interface that might also work between two different kinds of virtual machines. And if you specify it like that, it's also, so you don't have to specify the memory can be an internal part of the virtual machine if you basically pass on data and call data and turn data buffers.
So the other thing that this kind of, the other reason why this feels ugly-less to me is that it kind of adds in technical debt, because now for some weird reason, every time a call finishes, instead of copying data once, you'd have to copy it twice. Or at least you'd have to kind of copy some pointer twice, or...
And you only pay once, is that the argument, or...?
Well, it's not so much payment, it's just about the fact that, like, this lots of extra weird stuff is happening, some of which it ends up being kind of vestigial, but we have to keep it around.
Could you re-explain that one?
So after if this gets implemented, then there's going to be two ways to access the data of a call. Right. One of them is going to be to access it from the default byte, a return data byte array, and the other one is going to be to do a return data copy and access it from there. And like generally having two kind of redundant ways of doing something isn't really a nice programming practice.
Sure, that's because we have to retain backwards compatibility, right?
Well, right, but like, even still though, like, I don't want to... Like, if we follow that principle, then like I'm worried that 30 years down the line we're going to have 50 of these in order to retain backwards compatibility.
Mm-hmm. And we can, so... We can say that return data is empty if the return area of the call is non-empty.
Exists.
Mm. Yeah. Which doesn't really simplify, but at least there's only one way to do it at a certain time. So you can't combine these two ways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So would this also... Wait a minute. Never mind.
So would it help at all to have implement or like little test implementations to see just how complicated it is, or would it be kind of pointless because we're still stuck on the idea of it potentially being complicated to maintain backwards compatibility down the line?
I can imagine what it would take to implement all three of these in Python, and I still feel like EIPs 5 and 8 are like two lines each, and this will end up being like 10 to 15 or more.
Yeah, I mean 5.8 is it's a small change to a rule that is already quite complicated, and this is and this one adds a new object to the state, as you already said.
Okay, so it sounds like this might not potentially be a good candidate for Metropolis due to some questions, but if between now and the next Alcor dev call, there can either be an alternative or people can come to agreement on it, or I guess come around to the idea of implementing it, I think this can be brought up again. But yeah, I think we should continue the discussion on GitHub unless there's any more comments.
So, yeah. I mean, I think this solving this whole problem is really important. I wouldn't say we delay Metropolis because of that, but
this doesn't seem kind of as important as other Metropolis EIPs, but I fully support continuing to iterate on various proposals.
Cool, sounds good. Any other comments, Christian?
Nope.
All right, sounds good. So this one we will just continue on GitHub. So let's see, the next one is the Ropsten spam attack. So I am not up to date on everything, so if someone doesn't mind just kind of in a nutshell, just explaining what's going on there and if any action is being taken on the part of the devs to do anything, because it's pretty unstable right now is what I've been hearing. And additionally, if it's actually really needed for it to be stable for future testing for Metropolis or other things we're doing.
What is the current state of Ropsten, by the way? Like, is it still kind of warped, or...?
The current state basically is that, so as far as I know, apparently they just forked off their own version of Ropsten. So they rolled back about 100,000 blocks and started a soft fork from there. Regarding the main chain, it's kind of weird because at a certain point we converged on a stably Ropsten network, and everything was starting to get back together, and then all of a sudden, yet again, a huge, gigantic heavy chain appeared. So I'm guessing we have an actor who's actively trying to screw Ropsten. So at this point, and the problem is that he actually, so when he reached the blocks, decided 9 billion, and then when actually those 9 billion gas is used, then it's a considerable memory burn on the nodes, so it actually can take about 2 gigabytes of memory to just process a single block worth of, basically due to the huge state. So what we've tried, basically, I'm not sure whether I fully agree with the parity approach in doing a soft fork and placing a gas limit on top of. Basically, they forked and placed the maximum gas limit on the blocks. I'm not sure what that limit is, nor where they come from. But so that's possibly a solution that we can follow. Basically, just release a new version of Geth, or at least a developed version, which has basically bans the current spam chains and just reverting to some sane state and then syncing on whatever the next best is, which I'm assuming will be what Eric is pushing.
Arkady, yes. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, clear something, right? It's not like we're pushing it, we have not built it in the client yet. I mean, it's just a spec file that users can use and revert to a previous state. Some of them did.
Yeah, so the unfortunate thing from our perspective at least is that parity apparently has the configurability to limit the block estimates via config files to hard limit. As far as I know, other client has at least get does not have such a feature to the configurability feature to do to change protocol parameters, at least this parameter. So it means that if we want to follow on this path, we do need to do some development and releasing. It's not something too hard, but it's not something that we can just release in an hour either.
So this parameter that's configurable, how is it normally decided? Is it just hard-coded, or is it something that is adjusted by miners or users have to go in manually generally?
Currently, it's hard-coded in the spec file 4.7 million, which is maximum block, so the miners can still vary the gas limit up to that hard-coded maximum.
So I was talking to Peter previously a little bit about that, and some people might not like the idea of forcing basically a soft fork on the testnet. Couldn't we try to achieve the same thing by just increasing the difficulty on the testnet net by getting people with GPU miners to mine on the testnet, and thus make testnet either more difficult to get and maybe make the attack more defensive?
Yeah, I think that's a good suggestion, because I think the problem with trying to kind of push gas limits back into line by itself is that in order to make a gas limit attack, what the attacker has to have over 51% anyway, and if we close down this 151% attack avenue and the attacker wants to keep screwing with us, then the attacker may well just launch more traditional class 51% attacks over and over again. So
it shouldn't be very hard to push to mine it, so mine it enough to push out of the PPD so that the spam attack is just not feasible anymore. And also it replicates more the behavior on the mainnet, which is a good thing here.
I think that one of the problematic things is that basically most of the clients have some sort of reorg protection so that you don't get to reorg to large blocks or too deeply. Basically, gas currently doesn't allow you to reorg more than 60,000 blocks. And I'm not sure whether, parity has the limit that you basically cannot reorg deeper than the pruning limit, which is whatever, I don't know, 1,000 blocks maybe. So it's the problem is that in order for us to actually dump all this crap, we need people to sync from a previous point. Now for Geth, I can do this. So I'm trying to what I'm working on is to so in Geth we have the concept of bad block. So in a release we can add a bad block, and then if a client sees that his chain contains that bad block, it will just delete everything afterwards and start syncing from that point. And I'm currently working on a minor modification so that fast sync can be resumed, so that I can basically delete everything even if the user was fast sync, and then the user can actually proceed in a decent way without having to manually muck around. So I can do that. I'm not sure whether, for example, parity could do that.
Yeah, I have the same mechanism basically.
Then I guess we could try to push a new chain. We still would need to do a manual release in order to force clients to basically to dump one of their chains.
Okay, so Arkady, is there any strong conviction to maintain the fix the way you guys implemented it, or would it be a possibility to get in a chat with the rest of the client devs and see about this alternate way of coming to a consensus on which chain to dump and which block to continue on.
Sure, I mean, it doesn't matter much. We're fine with whatever makes sense. Mainly, that particular block, so it was before the bulk of the attack has started, it still has some state built into it in there, but not as much as was added in the following blocks.
Okay, and this, Peter, the approach you were talking about, does it, how much would it actually make some transactions that have occurred invalid to the point where, like, test dApps would lose some of their state and some of their changes that, you know, they've pushed to the network?
Well, consider that it's about 150,000 blocks, so, yeah, I'm quite certain that it will cripple stuff.
Okay.
There is a high enough probability that that the transactions are integrated on both chains, but I'm almost certain that some dApps will get screwed.
Okay, sounds good. Or I mean, it's not ideal, obviously, but good that we have clarity on that. So I'm not sure if there's any way to avoid that except to, I guess, pick the most used chain or fork Robston, which would be complicated in itself, I'm guessing.
Well, one thing that we can do is we could try to stick with the parity chain, because that they seem to have figured out a nice block number to fork from and maintain a semi-decent chain. So I'm fine with continuing on that one. I think the question is, how can we ensure that all clients end up somehow on that chain? And also, it would be nice to then figure out how to remove the block limit, because I personally kind of feels weird that we have a block limit on that. But still, in order to remove the block limit, it would be nice to know how we can protect against somebody trying to screw it again.
Yeah, I would imagine it would be more difficult to provide an incentive on the testnet, at least, for that to happen. I guess it wouldn't be impossible. It would just be getting people to combat it with their mining powers. The only way I can think of. Anyone else have thoughts on that, Vitalik?
So for example, there's one guy who's at a certain point he was running one of the biggest mining pools on Ethereum. He actually offered me personally that if he can afford to sacrifice a few of his GPUs to just try to push whatever chain you want on Robston.
Oh, okay. Well, that's pretty cool then. I think that's a good idea then. So let's go ahead and take this. This wouldn't be an EIP, obviously. We can take this into the All Core Devs channel on Gitter and coordinate with all the clients. And actually, Jan or Anton or any other clients that are in here, do y'all have any opinions on this, or is there going to be any issue implementing this on your side?
No, I don't think so.
So one possible solution is that one workable solution is still that we try to push one chain that we pick as being the canonical chain and make it heavier than whatever else is out there, and then all clients would automatically sync to that without having to do any modifications. So that's also possible. So I think if parity and geth can agree and can somehow sync to the same chain correctly, then the remainder of the clients can automatically sync if the chain becomes longer. I think geth and parity are kind of the important chains, the important clients to ensure that they sync correctly, because both geth and parity have caching power on the testnet. So if either of them picks a different chain, then it's split.
Yeah, I would say the most used clients for that would be geth parity and Ethereum J. Just because I think Harmony might use that testnet as the default. I'm not positive. So, but yeah, it sounds like because Anton said that it wouldn't be too hard for them to do something like that. We can just coordinate this in the Gitter channel. So any other comments on this? Okay, great. I also saw in the last 24 hours, this is item number 3, by the way, there was some discussion about miners not or miners using the old recommendation for gas price. Can anyone give kind of a quick synopsis on that and what's been done?
Sure. So basically the idea here is that there are so in general right now the offer is somewhere around either 20 Shannon or somewhere slightly above 20 Shannon, and some people are basically concerned because they expect that if given that the price of Ether has doubled over the last couple of weeks, the ETH-denominated gas price should go down to compensate, so the transaction fees don't get too high. The challenge is, though, is that while the idea that gas prices should be independent of Ether is scenario, in the current environment, the situation is a bit more complicated because basically the only reason why that miners have right now to not include transaction isn't because of they want to have space for other transactions or the gas limit. It's because they're afraid of increasing the probability that their block is going to be illegal, right? So this is something that a lot of miners started taking more seriously back during the DOS attacks. But the basic principle is that if you're blocks that are larger are blocks that take, and therefore more likely to not get propagated in time, or it's like totally their models. That's actually means about this, and actually Peter Pratcher from EtherScan made a couple more regressions today, and he discovered that currently the kind of efficient or gas price where the revenue they get from fees matches up with the cost that they have to pay for from the increased uncle rate. The equilibrium there is around 19 Shannon, right? Sorry, that's Peter Pratcher from Etherchain statistics / gas price. I could actually paste this into the TSG chat room. There it is.
Okay.
So right now, I think there's if we want to have if we want the gas price to go lower, then basically this aside from some constants would be to look at the way that inclusion has inclusion small. It actually makes the miners much less willing to include transactions than they otherwise would be. Can people still hear me, by the way?
Yeah, sometimes your connection gets a little bit slow, but it doesn't actually make you go away. It just slows down your speaking for a second, so you're still somewhat.
Okay. Sure.
Where did the link go? Thank you.
Yeah, I just pasted the link, but it doesn't seem like it's appeared in the chat yet.
Got it now.
Oh, got it. Okay. There it is. Yeah. Yeah, so basically the challenge is that if you look at the average block reward, the average uncle reward, it's around 3.4 Ether, but like if on-chain collusion was perfectly efficient, it would be all the way up to 4.375, and that would actually reduce the equilibrium gas price all the way back down to like 6 or 8 Shannon. So I remember that some developers started looked briefly at why this was happening, and I think basically the problem ended up being that there's a bunch of situations where when clients receive new blocks, they end up kind of not adjusting their work quickly enough, so the old uncles have been, or they basically don't add uncles in until a block after when they should be adding uncles into the pool of uncles that they're trying to create blocks with. So, if we want fees to go down, then looking at that would be one of the simplest or one of the easiest approaches. Aside from this, the only other thing would be, as I said, a hard fork to adjust some constants to try to incentivize miners to push more transactions on. But I don't think we're at the stage where that's needed.
So the non-hard fork solution, would that just be, I guess, would that be considered a soft fork or just an education for the miners?
It's not even a fork. It's a strategy change in the clients. And in fact, it's a strategy change in the clients that miners should support because it would give them more revenue.
Ah, okay. So it sounds like it's a dual changing, the clients changing how they, some of the stuff for their defaults, and then having something that shows miners the fact that it's optimum. And part of what I was thinking is maybe, I know that there's, for the Bitcoin community, there's certain sites that show like the optimum gas or the optimum transaction fee in order to get your transaction on the network. I wonder if there can be some kind of very basic like one-page site that shows the optimum strategy for miners to make the most money at the time using a formula.
That already exists. I linked to it 42 minutes ago.
Oh, great. Awesome.
No, look, the thing is, like, that's their optimum gas price, right? The optimum on-chain inclusion strategy is something that would have to be coded into the clients. It's not something that you can kind of set easily.
Ah, got it. Okay, that's different than, one of the parameters they can set. Okay. Let's start with parity. Parity, do you have any thoughts on that? Is that something that could be agreed upon and then changed?
Well, yeah, sure. We did a number of optimizations on that. So as for the gas price, so by default, we have it tied to the Ethereum price in USD. But as far as I know, major pools just don't use defaults. They override specified price.
Okay, sounds good. And then Go team.
I'm not entirely sure what the change would entail. We can change whatever, so it should be fine if there's a clear thing what to change. Just to react a bit to the parity's dollar approach, I think the problem is, one of the problems that I see in the network currently is that even if miners can't, so the problem if miners override the defaults, and apparently they do, then if average nodes do run with defaults which are below what miners say, then it might happen that the network starts to fill up with spam transactions that just circulate over all over the place without actually any miner including it. So that's my main issue with dynamically adjusting gas prices. That somehow average nodes need to adjust to what miners do, not to what the defaults are.
Yeah. By the way, on this general topic, I just wanted to make one suggestion. I'll actually ask, maybe this already exists, but if not, make it a suggestion, which is that aside from just being able to choose the gas price in terms of the number of way, maybe make it possible to choose the gas price like either even like in Web3.js as either a percentile or as a multiple of the average that gets included or something similar. The idea would be that that would just make it easier to pay more to get included quickly.
Is there anyone from Web3.js in here that can comment on that? I guess it would be Alex or Martin.
Nope. I think Pavin to come here, but he's, I think he was busy doing some other stuff.
I don't think the problem is including it fast. I think the problem is that how can we lower the gas price without opening up the network to deny a service attack. So basically we cannot lower it.
For myself personally, from a user experience standpoint, these for me are stepping like seconds instead of 3 minutes. Like that is something that it is a functionality that people I think wants to have, but. I do agree that like there is this other problem of how do we get miners to accept lower fees, and then how do we get miners to accept lower fees without, or how do we allow lower fees without making DOS situations worse? So on the third point, my current instinct is that I think first of all, regardless of whether fees are low or high. Like there is a risk that attackers are going to be willing to just make full blocks and just fill up full blocks forever, whether that's an attempt to make the blockchain not work well or whether it's an attempt to bloat the state. And I think if we're comfortable that all of the denial of service issues are fixed, then theoretically, like even if blocks are being 100% spammed the whole time, like that's something that nodes should theoretically be able to tolerate. But in terms of state-sized growth, I think that's an area where if we want to mitigate it, then we'd have to rebalance off-code gas prices again.
So it sounds like there's not a quick fix necessarily, but as long as the cost versus benefit is on the benefit side for, you know, enabling people to, I guess, have more freedom to choose. I think I'm following that correctly. Then that would, or to choose the gas price when they're actually sending their transaction, that can alleviate some of the issues that people are having.
Okay, so on that. Area, I was running some tests in Mist, but I was wondering exactly the thing with, right? And what I've seen is that 75...
Oh, Alex, could you get closer to your mic?
Hi, sorry. Can you listen to me?
Yep, we can hear you now, if you could start over.
Okay, so I ran some statistics in Mist. And over the last 1,000 blocks of all transactions that were included, over 75% of them were exactly 20 Shannon. And less than 1% were free, and only above that they are 20 Shannon limit. So basically that means that most people, even though that in Mist we include Even though in Mist we include the slider, most people don't change it to make it larger. And if you put it smaller than 20 Shannon, the transaction will never be accepted. So most people do not change the default slider.
Okay, I mean, if it's not too pressing, then that's fine, but it's still nice to have.
Yeah, I definitely agree that when the price rises, the idea that the transaction cost should go down is something that most users expect.
Okay, so yeah, that would be, I guess, a suggestion for the Web3 team, right?
For the Web3 team? Sorry, why the Web3 team?
Oh, okay, maybe I'm not following this correctly, but I thought it was the user being able to... Or I guess they already can adjust that in Mist. Never mind.
Yeah, they can adjust that in Mist, but if you put it lower than 20 Shannon, then your transaction will not be relayed and you will not be included in any mining node.
Okay, so yeah, if everyone else doesn't think it's a pressing issue, it doesn't need to be resolved today necessarily. So, any other comments?
So, I do think it's a semi-pressing issue. At least we don't have to solve it now, but it would be nice to solve it rather in the short term than the long term. So, basically, if we can figure out how to prevent the network from being DOSed offline, I'm fine with whatever solution.
Peter, can you just clarify, are you specifically concerned about DOSes in terms of kind of short-term impact? So, like, pushing local rates very high, making it hard for nodes to stay synced, or are you thinking about more long-term DOSes that try to, like, bloat up the state to make it really big over the course of a couple of months?
Actually, neither of them. I wasn't talking about the blockchain. I was talking about the network itself. So.
Oh, network. Okay. I agree that's something that probably needs to be studied much more.
So, I think last Christmas, 2014 or 15 Christmas, there was an issue with the network that we were propagating. Every node was just sending around tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of invalid transactions. And it was actually slowing down. And we did fix that issue, but actually it was kind of an eye-opener that a lot of things can go really wrong if you allow if you allow transactions to circulate the network, that will never ever be included. So it's not something that we should lightly add.
Yeah. So just to clarify, the problem is that even though parity miners, if they use their defaults, they'll mine, they'll accept transactions at 10 Shannon with gas price of 10 Shannon. The gas nodes won't relay those transactions, so effectively you can't broadcast a transaction with less than 20 Shannon because of gas relay policy.
So, Peter, is that something that sounds accurate for the way Geth operates on default?
Yeah, that's absolutely how it operates. But that's also kind of my point, that if you start circulating transactions that won't be included by any miner, then you will cripple the network.
Okay. So yeah, unless there's any more comment, it sounds like this needs more... Sounds like this needs more study, so...
For example, one thing that we could try to do is... so parity old approach is to tie the gas price to the dollar value. Although I really find that a horrible idea from a centralization point of view, because it means you just call an API of one of the exchanges and hope that it won't fuck your entire network up. So that's my biggest issue with it, because you're kind of placing the whole fee market in the hands of an exchange. But if you can tie it in a more or less reasonable way to the dollar value, then maybe at least miners, but probably there will be some miners who won't manually change it, so maybe they will at least, I don't know, maybe we can try to play around with it. The problem is you won't see the negative effect. And by the time you see the negative effects, it's too late to fix.
Oh, Arcady, on the parity client, is there any, plan if the exchanges or whatever data source is manipulated? Is there multiple data sources that are pulling for that U.S. dollar price?
Currently, there's just one data source. But it's checked for being sane, I think. And you can always override it.
Okay.
The second is really, so if given that Ether price is around $20 currently, I would say that between $5 and $100, everything would kind of look sane. So, but it could really impact the network a lot.
Okay. So there's a few different, it sounds like there's a few different suggestions. Peter, if you could just do a summary write-up of kind of what we talked about on the issue, we can circulate that for more discussion and see if we can't come up with a short to intermediate term solution, unless it's something more pressing. I don't exactly have a grasp on how pressing or how tied it is to the price, so...
Yeah, definitely. I'll try to summarize some stuff and at least voice my concerns so that other people can also read through it. And then we can figure it out.
Okay, great. Yeah, if you write that up and send it to me, I'll circulate it on the appropriate channels for Parity, Ethereum J, Ruby, all the other ones, and maybe even Reddit if appropriate.
Sure. I think I will. Whether I already have something like that
written
up, I have to find it.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Any other comments on that?
I would just add that the transaction relay policy is important to, I think it's worth an EIP to specify, the networking layer, the transaction relay policy, because right now, the abstraction of transaction origin, the account abstraction, it won't work if guest nodes don't relay transactions with zero gas price.
So is that something... go ahead.
So let's suppose that we start relaying transactions with zero gas price, and I start firing out contract calls from a million different accounts all at the same time. Since it's zero gas price, it means that they are all valid. What happens then in the network?
So that's one of the, spam DOS vectors that you were referring to earlier?
Yeah, so the problem is that I can basically churn out infinite number of transactions that are completely valid, yet they will never ever be processed. And I can, the problem is that given zero gas price, I can actually create new, brand new transactions. I can just create them as fast as I can and shove them into the network at different nodes, and they will start propagating it. And even if they drop some of them, I don't care. As long as they propagate something, the network will start getting sluggish.
Okay, that does sound like a concern. Okay, so yeah, any other comments? Otherwise, it sounds like Peter's going to summarize all of this since it's a non-trivial but, can be solved issue. Oh, Daniel, your microphone's not working.
So these DOS attacks can be mitigated by a prioritization of forwarding transactions and not necessarily some kind of policy. That's my only comment.
So Daniel, your microphone just went haywire and sounded like a robot who is screaming for dear life. If you could repeat what you said and just look at chat, we'll tell you, or the chat in Google Hangouts, we'll tell you if it does it again, if you can adjust anything. And it might be a combination of your microphone volume, input volume, and your how close you are to it.
Okay, is it any better now?
Oh, it's perfect now. So if you could just repeat what you said.
Okay, so I said that my only comment was that it is not necessary, the solution to these DOS problems is not necessarily a hard cutoff policy of whether to forward transactions or not forward, but it might also be solved by prioritization. That if a node is having many transactions to choose from, then it might choose which transactions to forward first. That might also mitigate DOS attacks as described by Peter. That was my only comment.
Yeah, that's true. The problems start happening when, for example, an attacker would try to propagate transactions that cost a lot of money, yet they will not be included for some reason, and they actually might prioritize out legitimate transactions. So there's, for example, I create a transaction that requires 4 million gas, but costs little, then Shannon, and then a shit ton of subsequent transactions that are really, really, really expensive. But since each of them would consume a full block, or maybe I'll create 10 blocks worth of transactions really cheaply, and then a ton of really, really expensive transactions. And then everybody will be spinning around the expensive transactions, whereas they won't get included anytime soon. And the legitimate transactions get starved. I'm sure it's possible to solve it. I'm just saying that it's not an obvious solution.
Okay, so yeah, it could even potentially be a combination of the some of the things you talked about and optimizing what gets relayed. So yeah, and I guess you have to also judge if these rules or these changes would even be followed, or if they can be made in a way that, you know, everyone cooperates for the best interest of either themselves or the network. So yeah, this is an interesting problem. Yeah, any other comments on this? Okay. So yeah, the last item that's officially on the agenda, and just by the way, before we go into this fourth item, is there any other ones that didn't make it on the agenda that someone wanted to cover after item four? Nope. Okay. So we're going to go ahead with agenda item four, which would be the Metropolis EIPs. So from my perspective of where we're at with that, there's going to be some people who are formalizing them and PRs. The EIP editor team has been going in and providing suggestions or getting them to conclusion as far as making sure that they're syntactically correct by the EIP standard and that there isn't any glaring errors. Does anyone else have comments? I know Vitalik has written a good majority of them, or maybe all of them. So you can go ahead with your summary.
I mean, I don't think I have any serious new updates on any of the Metropolis EIPs. My smoke is, well, working with Christian on finalizing some of the privacy-related ones, going to be working with Jeff soon on implementing them. So that would be all up to curves and pairings. Aside from that, I don't think I've had any new insights since the last call.
Okay. About a month ago, I know Martin Holswinde had brought up the issue of the difficulty bomb. Is there an update on that as far as the network changes that may have prolonged that, or if there is something that needs to be planned and what time frame?
Practically speaking, I think it all has to be prolonged. So I did the math, and I think I can just redo the math right now. Hold on. This is just on what the Ice Age is going to look like.
Yeah, because I feel like there should be somewhat of a, at least a an emergency mitigation strategy if needed, at minimum, but also just kind of thinking about if anything right. needs to be done.
Okay, there, I'm going to run my script with the latest data, and it looks like at the end of March, the block time is going to be around 14.6 seconds. At the end of June, it's going to go up to what, it'll be at about 20 to 21 seconds, and at the end of August, it'll be 32 seconds.
Okay.
As far as as far as mitigations go, for example, is that in a difficulty calculation function, we would basically let's say if the block number is less than 4 million, then use that. If it's the block number is between 4 and 6 million, then just use the number 4 million. And if it's above 6 million, then use the block number minus 2 million. So we would just add a kind of artificial discontinuity.
Okay. And that's something that would hold up all the way until the potential transfer from proof of work to proof of stake?
Yes. Yes. So an update on the transfer to proof of stake, by the way, is that with my latest kind of thinking, if you want more details, I wrote a bunch of Medium posts and I'm going to keep writing more, is that it does seem like there actually might be a possibility of doing a kind of slow transition. So where we would go switch from proof of work to proof of work with proof of stake running on top, that doesn't really mean anything, to hybrid proof of stake to kind of more full proof of stake over time. So even though implementing 100% of that roadmap might take longer, so I could see it taking more than a year, we would get to some of the earlier stages possibly ahead of schedule. So that's just the information to think about.
Yeah, I've recently heard an interview with Rick Dudley, I think that's how you say his name, where he was mentioning the, the certainty that there would be a time in the transition process where proof of work and proof of stake would be running alongside each other, and also figuring out, how the EVMs are going to, work beside each other, or if there's complete compatibility. Complete compatibility with EVM 1 versus the EVM 2. So yeah, my question basically is the for the POW and POS running alongside each other, would that be something that is still a little bit unexplored, or is it pretty much known that through these transitions that it's going to take months to kind of decouple the two?
So what do you mean by decoupling?
So running them at the same time, at what...
So it's not going to be two blockchains, right? That's...
Oh, no, not two blockchains, two... So proof of work and proof of stake at the same time.
Two algorithms,
yeah.
Right?
No problem.
Yeah. So the idea would basically be, right, that we could first implement the proof of stake part very conservatively, so that the proof of stake would basically only finalize blocks after proof of work has de facto finalized them anyway. Then over the course of a couple of months, we would implement clients that would favor the proof of stake fork choice rule. Then we would probably cut down the proof of work block reward, increase add a proof of stake validator reward. then we would implement some hybrid proof-of-stake scheme that would let us kind of parameterize between proof-of-work and proof-of-stake on a 0 to 100 scale, and then we would just implement that. And so the first part would not even be a hard fork. It would be like a very weird kind of soft fork. And the second part would be a hard fork, but it could be one that kind of eases into the new version over the course of maybe 100 days or something.
Okay. So it's just more of an issue of implementation and coordination once the research team, I guess, somewhat officially wraps up the process on
exactly
how that can go. Okay. Sounds good.
Yeah. So by the way, stage one is already being implemented in the form of a Python daemon that talks to Jeff through RPC.
Oh, okay. So is that something that's also in any other clients or just implemented, not actually
so
pushed?
So theoretically, can talk to any client with RPC.
Okay.
Oh, I see. So my instinct would be to keep it pure Python for now because it's still kind of in iteration mode. But once it settles, then it should probably be implemented into clients directly.
Okay, and the timeline for that is post-Metropolis, it sounds like?
Yeah, for implementing it into the 7 clients is post-Metropolis. For doing it in Python, it will happen in parallel, and we can keep doing it in parallel.
Okay, sounds good. So I guess if I were to create a summary on the Metropolis stuff, the EIPs are seeming to go well. There is some discussion on them. We're going to continue to monitor the PRs, and the editors are going to look to make sure those are moving along and don't get stalled as far as discussion and other things are concerned. Finally, when is there a need to actually put a block number down for Metropolis? It sounds like the last time we talked, two meetings ago, we were talking about making it a fairly conservative number to allow a ton of time for testing and to have less rushed hard fork in order to avoid any issues we've had previously.
A less rushed hard fork, you mean to actually do Metropolis?
Yeah, when you actually do Metropolis. Because, Homestead wasn't rushed either, but like some of the recent hard forks, there was a cadence of, you know, having a hard fork performed within a month just because of having to mitigate attacks and other things. So I guess this one... Oh, you can go.
Sorry, I didn't quite hear all of that.
Yeah, so I was just saying the cadence of recent hard forks has been rushed. So Jeff implied 2 meetings ago that we should be given plenty of time. So is there any comments on how much time that should be, or if there is a need to actually set kind of a rough time in the next couple of weeks or something to decide on the block number or things like that?
So I don't think we should be deciding on the block number until the C++ client has created tests and until all clients are passing the test. The thing that we can decide is the wait time. So the time between, we really recommend making a starting to go longer for that. So like maybe go up to something like 3 weeks.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds reasonable. Or 3 weeks pending any issues that may arise that would...
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yep, that sounds good. Any other comments on the Metropolis EIPs?
Is that a quite specific question about the account abstraction? Is it the case that if we have this special zero signature, then the sender is... set to -1 in air quotes
yes.
For all? Okay. So anyone can spend money that might be there, for example?
Yes.
Okay.
All right, sounds good. Any other comments on Metropolis?
I think it'd be good to have an idea of when we're shooting for, you know, to do the fork, whether, you know, is it August, you know, is it would it be okay to do it when blocks are, block time is 30 seconds, or would we prefer it closer to, you know, 15 or 20 seconds?
Hmm. My personal preference would be end of June, but...
So yeah, and that kind of sounds like it's dependent on the implementations and the discussions over what's
included. If implementation's longer than we can, then obviously end up happening a bit longer or a bit later.
Okay, there can I agree with Casey though. There needs to be, some sort of at least assurance that there is a time frame we're shooting for in order for the network block time to not go up to an unsatisfactory level for the majority of the – or a level that the majority of the community would think is an unsatisfactory level. So
one concern is that if the block times get too high, then a lot of hash power might switch to a more profitable chain.
I would argue that at this point, Ether is just like so far ahead of other cryptocurrencies in terms of dollars per second that I'd argue the number of risk of that is actually lower than the extent to which you'd make people happy by temporarily reducing the inflation rate.
Okay. Sounds good. And
actually did the math. Back when Ether was at $5, I would have definitely suggested much more caution. Back when Ether was at $5 and Zcash was at $50, but now that Ether is at $19 and Zcash is at $40, it's the concern there is further away.
Okay. And if there is a change such that somehow we get back to the state you were or the conditions, not necessarily the price of $5, but other conditions in the cryptocurrency ecosystem, would this be able to be the time frame adjusted and we feel safe enough to do it by, would it still be kind of shooting for end of June, or would it need to be pushed up quicker for Casey's concerns?
I think end of June should be unobjectionable because, look, 20 seconds versus 14.2 isn't that much. But if once we start talking about 14.2 versus 30, like, that's a different issue. So if under those conditions, yes, we'd have to probably push Metropolis up ahead and kick out a future or two.
Okay. Sounds good. So, yeah, we can cross that bridge when we come to it, it sounds like. And we'll just be monitoring that over the next few All Core Dev calls. Any other Metropolis-related comments?
Christian, I wanted to ask, has there been progress on implementing these in C++, and does it look like we're close to having tests for them?
The blocker currently is integrating libsnark properly. Okay. The implementation should be 100% finished. So,
okay.
And Dimitri already started some tests.
Perfect. In that case, I'd recommend starting tests for everything except for the snark stuff.
And
So the snark stuff is implemented, the rest not yet. Or what was the question?
I was asking about the all of the Metropolis features other than the snark stuff.
We started work on the other stuff, and the snark stuff is mostly
ready. Okay, got it, thank you. That's
okay, cool. Any other clients wanting to comment on their progress on some of the implementation? Arkady, I saw the Parity team, I think, was in the process of at least doing initial implementations of 86.
Yeah, that's right. It's a work in progress. So, yeah, mostly we're waiting on the tests. That's the most pressing concern.
So, concerning 86, does our current test infrastructure allow for these tests? Because, I mean, when transactions come in via block, they should all be valid, right? So what I'm saying is we don't have test infrastructure to test the mining strategy, right?
Right. and yeah, we haven't implemented that at all.
All right, sounds good. So we're waiting on test, and then that'll help with testing. But it sounds like we're still at least finalizing some of the specs, so that can definitely happen in parallel.
Yeah. In general, if we want to test mining strategy, then one thing you could do is you could just put your miner up on Robston, and on Robston check, you know, if you create blocks, then make sure that the uncle rewards that at least for uncles that you're including are at 4.375.
Okay. So that could even be coordinated if we want beforehand, if we just figure out the Robston miners, if we can just ask them to do that.
Right. I mean, well, this is a strategy thing, so it doesn't really need client coordination.
Oh, okay. Oh, so yeah, that's right. Cool. And then, I think, is there anything else Metropolis-wise anybody had a comment on?
Can't think of anything.
Cool. Quick shout out to Yoichi's work. He just released a blog post on formally verifying some of the, it looked like it was putting it like graphically, some of the things that are coming up for proof of stake and some of the stuff the research team has been doing.
Yeah, so that was the Vitalik version of Casper. And actually, this week, Vlad Zamir came to the Berlin office, and now Vlad and I are doing something similar for Vlad Casper. And I think, I'm explaining everything to these machines, so now I think this helps explaining things to people as well. So, yeah, clarifying lots of things.
Awesome. Sounds good. Good job. And last point is that the EIP editors are currently meeting periodically to go through EIPs. Again, if anyone in here has an EIP, especially one that is mid-2016 or older, if you could go in and update them to say, this is something that I still want to do, or this can be closed, or close it yourself, that would be incredibly helpful because we are crunching through, I think, 156 or so EIPs that are in various states of abandonment or just like some in progress stuff, including stuff from 2015. So, if you could go in there and do that, that'd be very helpful. And then we're also checking the PRs fairly frequently every few weeks to make sure that those kind of stay in line. So, I think other than that, is there any other comments from anybody?
Yes, just one quick question. On the last meeting, Robert proposed a semi-formal EIP that we should dump the ETH_compile RPC endpoints. And I think it kind of makes sense, and most of the people agreed. I think he also proposed an EIP based on the link. And more or less everybody said that it's a good idea. So as far as I know, apparently already merged in PR to delete it. We also have an open PR. My question is, is this something that we are going to sue with? And if yes, then probably we can just accept it as accept the EIP or something. Unless someone has an objection.
So the most important thing to watch out here is to update the tutorials accordingly, right?
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah, so that's a valid point.
And would this then be handled by the group that makes the DApp frameworks, I guess? As far as once you take it away?
So as Robert, I think Robert also pointed out on the issue, the EIP proposal, that the problem is that nobody really uses these endpoints anymore because, for example, many people want to select which version of Solidity they want to compile, but it's not possible to do that. Then it's not really, so I don't think people heavily depend on these kind of things. Maybe we can shout out on Reddit to just ask whether somebody's actually using it. But it's actually, it doesn't really make any sense to use the underscore compile solidity versus just using Solsi directly.
Okay.
So I hear a lot of people coming in asking about how to use it so that it doesn't work, basically, and I guess it's all beginners who are trying to follow the tutorials.
Okay, so updating the tutorials would need to be something that is looked at, and right now the tutorials, or at least the ones that the foundation has more or less produced, are pretty outdated themselves, so that's a whole different issue. But inside that EAP, we can kind of discuss how to move forward with that in the best way.
Actually, regarding that, maybe, I'm not sure, Christian, whether you guys have some tutorial page for Solidity. Because I know that, for example, the Go Ethereum wiki pages, somebody sometime 2.5 years ago, maybe Victor, he wrote some Solidity tutorials that are horribly out of date. And in all honesty, I don't really feel that Solidity tutorials should be in the Go Ethereum wiki page because they have nothing to do with Go Ethereum. And honestly, I don't think it's something that we as the Go team would like to maintain. But nonetheless, people do find it, and then people come nagging us that it's outdated. And yeah, it sucks that it's outdated, but we don't want to maintain Solidity tutorials nonetheless.
I actually was not aware that there is a tutorial on the GIF wiki. I was mainly talking about the tutorials that are on the Ethereum.org website.
Mm-hmm. So I think that it would be a really nice thing if we could maybe have a more, I wouldn't say organized approach, but maybe an organized effort to try and maybe create a tutorial page that we can just link to, and then at least we can maintain only a single place and not scatter.
Yeah, ethdocs.org was our initial attempt at that, and that's kind of fallen as not a priority compared to some of the other stuff the maintainers were doing. So I might do a shout out on Reddit to see if anyone wants to pick up on that. And anyone here, the ethdocs.org, there's a repository in the Ethereum GitHub account that's called like Homestead Docs. That really needs to be updated to something more generic, but I hopefully will have time soon to do that. There's a few things more pressing because I was one of the main maintainers. The other ones were Bob Summerwell and Victor Tron, and I know Victor's been all in on Swarm and stuff lately, so I know he can't maintain it. So it's more of an issue on that front of finding someone to maintain it and keep up with the changes. So I'll see if anyone in the community can take that on, along with maybe someone who works on a core client just helping with their piece of that. And so that's pretty much the deal with that. And I'll comment on the EIP to see how we can move that along as far as a plan and what type of EIP it should be. Cool. Is there any other comments? Great. All right, I think we're good here. I'm going to upload this recording in the next few days. I'm behind on uploading the recordings, but that should be fixed pretty soon. I'll have 10 and 11 up. So thanks, everybody. We'll have another meeting, I guess, in 2 weeks, which would be the third Friday of the month. We're on a cadence now of the first and third Fridays every month. So thank you, everybody. Have a good weekend.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.